All right, so I think we can go ahead and get started. Welcome everyone. We're so happy to have you all join us for our very first webinar to kick off Microsoft March. Just a quick reminder, this webinar is being recorded and it will be posted online later on for future viewing. So you can revisit it anytime if you miss anything or you want to look back on it. So just a little intro, Microsoft March is IT Solutions' annual celebration of Microsoft Office 365 and all the amazing apps and tools that you have access to as a student, faculty, or staff member here at Minnesota State University Mankato. So all March long, we're helping educate and share tips and resources on Office 365 with online help articles and a series of special training webinars just like this one. So if you want to check out our other resources or register for any of our upcoming webinars, you can head over to mankato.mnsu.edu/Microsoft March. We'd love to see you all at our upcoming webinars as well. All right, so with that out of the way, let's begin our webinar. So today's topic is Intro to Microsoft Office 365. So we'll give a bit of a basic introduction and how to get started with these tools. My name is Lexi Potter, and I'm going to be helping host this session. I'm the Strategic Communications Coordinator for IT Solutions. And in just a moment, I'll hand things over to our presenters. We have Brian Johnson and Steve Rodman here with us. They're both solutions architects here at IT Solutions. And just a last reminder, if you have questions throughout the webinar, feel free to use that Q&A function or just go ahead and send them in the chat. I'll do my best to read those off. Otherwise, we'll save 10-ish minutes at the end for more questions if you have them as well. So with that, I'll go ahead and hand it off to Brian and Steve.
Hello, thank you, Lexi. Steve, can you hear me? Steve, I think you're on mute.
I am on mute because nobody wants to hear me.
It's a tradition like no other in Zoom meetings. One person has to start talking while they're on mute.
This is all right.
True. So I'm going to stop my video and make sure my share is working here. And everyone should be seeing my screen right now, which is showing just the Google interface right now because I'm using Google Chrome. And so today we just wanted to get started by showing all the tools that we have available to us in Office 365. And really to demonstrate that, we want to start at the same place that most of our students, staff, and faculty start at, which is with MavMail. So by walking through, I just want to first show you how to access this. So we're going to start from having just joined or acting like someone who has just joined the university and maybe hasn't accessed before. So most of you joining this session, I'm sure you have already figured out how to access MavMail, but we're just going to start from the beginning in case in the future people watch this video and want to follow along with how to get started with Office 365. So I'm going to start the demonstration by, in my search bar, just searching for MavMail. And once I do that, it uses my default web search tool that's built into my browser. The default for me right now is Google, and it finds MavMail because at Minnesota State Mankato, Office 365, our email client, we refer to it as MavMail, and it powers our email. So I'll select that first option. It will take you to the IT Solutions page here for logging into Office 365/MavMail. And I'll click on log into Office 365. And we're using a demo account. So typically here on the screen, what you would see is a prompt or a reminder to sign in with either star ID at go.minstate.edu, which is our login credentials for students to use, or star ID at minstate.edu, which is for accessing faculty and staff accounts. So again, for students, that's at go.minstate.edu, and for staff, it's at minstate.edu. But we're using a demo account, so I'm going to put in those credentials. And as I go through the login process, the next step is it's going to ask for my password. And the following step for most users now, as we start to roll out multi-factor authentication, would be to authenticate using whatever the secondary authentication method that you typically use is. So for me, it's the Microsoft Authenticator app. Some people, you might have a text message or a phone call set up. So once you click sign in, that's when Microsoft will double check, hey, is it you that's signing into this account? And if so, click approve to allow the multi-factor authentication process to move forward. So with this demo account, we don't have that. So I'm gonna click sign in. And then I'm gonna be prompted with the stay signed in prompt. And this is a useful tool. So just some guidance here. You got a decision right off the bat to make to decide whether to stay signed in or not. And with this question, it really comes down to if you're using a secure computer or not. If you're using a computer where you're borrowing somebody else's device, or maybe it's a family computer, I would recommend saying no to this screen. But if you're using a university computer that's issued to you and you keep it locked and password protected, then I would recommend saying yes. And then it just reduces the amount of times that you have to go through the authentication process. Now that comes with an important caveat though, that you need to make sure that your computer is secure when you are when you're not around it or not using it, or that when you walk away from your computer that you're locking it so that people can't access your Office 365 account. Because as we get into all the various apps and all the ways that you can store information in Office 365, it's important that we keep that information secure. So I'll go ahead and click yes, because I'm using a secure computer. And a little tip for you, if you're using a Windows computer and you work in a shared environment, or shared workspace like we do in IT solutions, a quick tip for locking your Windows computer is to press the Windows key and the L button simultaneously. Don't push it now or it'll lock your computer, but after this training, I encourage you to give it a try. Press the Windows key and L button, and that's just a quick way to lock your computer. All right, so I just logged into my Outlook account, and you can see it's a brand new account. It actually, because I don't have any emails in my inbox, it gives me a list of things that I can do to kind of learn the application. But we want to talk about more than just Outlook and Mavmail. We really want to dive into what else is included with Office 365. So I think most people, when they get started, they're familiar with Mavmail because it's the official communication method of the university. So right away when people are onboarded, either as a student, faculty, or staff, one of the first things that they get access to and want to access so that they can stay apprised of university information is their Mavmail account. Okay, so we think this is the starting place for most people. And from here to learn to explore what else is available in Office 365, we're gonna navigate up to this upper left-hand corner. You can see this grid of dots. I think a lot of people refer to it as the waffle menu. And if you press that, it will open up and show you a list of all the apps that are available as part of Office 365. And this is actually an incomplete list. So I'm gonna go down here to where it says all apps, and I'm gonna give that a tap, and you'll see the list grows even taller. And I can actually search right here if I'm looking for a specific app. But for this demonstration, I'm gonna go ahead and click explore all your apps. And this will take me to a screen that shows a full list of apps. Okay. Steve, am I still coming through loud and clear?
You are. You're sounding great.
All right. Thanks for the distraction. I just wanted to quick pop over to this other screen. So the demo account that we had set up has a different license than we do as staff members. So I wanted to just take a moment there to bring up my screen so we can talk about the apps here.
Yep. Another small side note, when you click on the waffle to have the apps expand, that list that comes up at first, you can actually pin your favorite apps up there for quick access.
Oh, that is a great tip. Thank you, Steve. Unpin from launcher, or if I have one that's lower on my list, I'm guessing there's an opportunity that I can pin it. It looks like I just have lots of apps pinned. So thank you.
You just want them all. That's wrong with that.
That's true. I am a power user. I'm using many of these apps daily. All right, so now I'm showing the screen here that lists all the apps that are available to us as part of Office 365. So I think just a quick overview, what most people are familiar with when we talk about Microsoft Office is, of course, Outlook, what we call Mavmail. But then the other most popular apps that have been around for a long time that everyone's probably used at some point or another is Microsoft Word. So down here at the bottom of the list, Microsoft PowerPoint for giving presentations, building slides, that kind of thing. And then Microsoft Excel, which is really a power tool for spreadsheets and building tables and storing and analyzing data. But then there's lots of other apps that you might not know are part of Office 365. So let's just start here in the upper left-hand corner. A really great and powerful app here is Bookings. Bookings is a tool for scheduling people. So as an individual, you can create a bookings page for yourself, or if you have a team of people that you want to be bookable, you can build a bookings page for that team. And in fact, during the pandemic, to prepare for making sure that we only have so many people use some of the resources on campus, such as an auto recreation center, some of the weightlifting areas and that kind of thing, we made it so that you could include spaces. So I think it was originally designed to be used for people's calendar, but if you reach out to the IT Solutions Center and you have a space that you want to have a bookings page, we can work with you on that. So the next app that I think we should talk about is Forms. This is another app that has really taken off, and some of the competitors or a competitor that you might be familiar with Forms is Google Forms. Here at Minnesota State Mankato, we are Office 365 customers. So our version of that is Microsoft Forms. And with this, you can make really beautiful forms or quizzes and polls. And it takes all that data and puts it into an Excel table for you, or you can view the forms submitted individually.
And we'll have a more in-depth dive into forms later in the month in our apps you have but might not know it.
Great reminder, thank you, Steve. Yes, the throughout this month, as we have other sessions, we're gonna be highlighting OneNote, which I'll get to here in a bit, OneDrive and Teams. But also, like Steve mentioned, at the end of the month, we're going to have apps that you have but haven't heard of, where we dive a little deeper onto these apps. So I think we'll likely highlight or really dive into what creating a bookings page looks like, or dive into creating a form with Microsoft Forms. All right, so then the next app that I think is really a powerhouse in Office 365 is OneDrive. And a popular competitor to that is Dropbox or Google Drive. And what it is, essentially, it's a place in the cloud for you to store your files. And it's really powerful. You get 1 terabyte of storage per user, and that can actually be increased. So if you're someone who uses large files as faculty and staff, for sure, students, I'll have to check the license. I can't recall right off the bat if they're eligible for an increase, but I know faculty and staff, if you're like in our geography department, works with large file sizes. If they needed to increase from 1 terabyte to 5 terabytes, for example, they could put in a request and have that increased. The next app here, OneNote. I'm a big fan of Microsoft OneNote. It's a way to store your information. Just think of it like a notebook. And in fact, you can have multiple notebooks, and it's broken out by sections and tabs and pages, and so you can just store all your information. But what makes it better than a real notebook is, one, that it's digital and online, and two, that it's searchable. So if you go to meetings, a couple meetings every day over the course of a couple of years, and you work on several projects and you're gathering information at all these meetings, it can be difficult to find what you're looking for. But with the power of OneNote, it adds a search bar and the ability to search within your notes to find exactly what you're looking for. The next app I would like to talk about is Planner, which is really a powerful tool for planning projects. So everyone might be familiar with, if we look down here at to-do, everyone has personal to-do lists, and it's built into Outlook. I think people have been using to-do lists of one sense or another for a long time, but Microsoft has really done a good job of building it into the Office 365 suite. And with Planner, they take it to the next level in that all the tasks that you create are on cards, and they're stored in a Kanban style that makes it really easy for teams to see where various tasks are at. And then you can assign the tasks to different people too. So if you're on a 5-person team, you can give, you know, task A, B, and C to one person and D, E, and F to another person. And you can see as those move along through the project from start to completion.
I think that's a great point to emphasize here, Brian, is that one of the biggest advantages of diving in and utilizing the Office 365 platform here at Minnesota State Mankato is that everyone in the university, faculty, staff, students, they all have access to this. So you don't need to worry about getting their email right or making sure they got that invite in an outside system. If you want to share or assign things, it's a matter of looking them up in our directory and having that go to that actual person.
Great point. Yeah, so we have some departments out there that maybe had purchased a solution before really knowing Office 365, and it was probably closed to just the people in that department. And with Office 365, this is an enterprise-wide solution. So all of our students, all of our faculty, all of our staff are right here. You don't have to worry about setting up a whole separate process for importing users or managing accounts. It's all built in. And like Steve said, it's really easy to add someone within our system or within the university into a team to work on a plan and to see the same data that you're seeing. So the next app in our list is Power Apps, which is really, I would say, a real power user, a real pro style app. It's a low code, no code solution for building applications. It might not be for most users, but it is a really powerful tool if you get a chance to learn and use Power Apps. And following right after that, part of the Power Platform is Power Automate, which is really great for creating workflows and repeatable tasks. So if, for example, you find yourself doing a repeatable task that it feels like, you know, why do I have to do this every week or every month? It feels like a computer could do this. Power Automate is the tool for that. So you can set up, for example, if you're reminding your team to submit their purchasing information every week, you could set up a Power Automate task to do that for you. Do you have any other examples, Steve, of where you've used Power Automate? I know you've built some tools where it takes data that's sent via email and collects it into a single storage spot and things like that.
Yeah, Power Automate is a great tool, as you mentioned, you know, for reminders. But if you have a position where you're, you know, getting emails that need to get, you know, routed in a certain place or processed in a certain way, you know, you can have a Power Automate kind of scan your inbox. And so when you get that new message, right, perhaps you need to forward that on to somebody else and then put it in a certain folder in your inbox. Like, you can have a Power Automate automatically do some of that stuff. You can link that up with forms as well. And so when a new form is submitted, you can have a Power Automate take some of that data and write it into another spot for someone else to look at or analyze as well. A great tool. Again, a kind of a low code method. And if you're not careful, like me, you can send yourself a few dozen emails before you get it right. But it's a great tool and works very well.
Great, thank you. And an important thing to note here, a lot of these tools, some of them are really intuitive and easy to use right out of the gate. Some of them get a little more complex. And if you need assistance, if you want to get rolling with one of these and you need assistance, as always, you can submit a ticket to the IT Solutions Center at mnsu.edu and just request assistance getting started with a Power Automate. Now, what we'd really like, and I'll show how to do this later, is that you kind of learn the tool using LinkedIn Learning and try some things out that way. But if you're looking at setting up a system for your department or trying to figure out how to collaborate and you just need someone to work with on that, on kind of mapping out or designing how that works, our IT Solutions Center staff or our solutions architects are here to help you with that. So continuing on, the next Power app is Power BI, which BI stands for Business Intelligence. And it's really just a great tool for showing graphs and charts or analyzing data in engaging data dashboards, as the description says here. As we look at budgets, I know a lot of users on campus will be referring to Power BI reports to see how their department budgets are looking. And it's just really a powerful tool for taking data from, you know, tables of columns and rows and making it make more sense by using graphs and charts. The next one we already talked about with PowerPoint. After that is Project, which I think is maybe a special license in my account because we use Project as part of our team. I can't recall for sure if that's available to everyone, so I'll move on from that. The next one after that, though, is SharePoint. SharePoint is the best way I could describe SharePoint is imagine a website where you get to control who has access to it, and it uses the credentials of other people in Office 365. So I could create a website that's designed only for the IT solution staff, and it could contain data that only the IT solution staff should have access to, for example. I've seen it used for different student departments or for student data where it's information that their students need access to, but they don't necessarily want it out on the web and indexed by Google and coming up in search results when people are searching for the university. And so SharePoint is a good tool for making that information available on a web page type format, but controlling who has access to it using their Office 365 credentials. I hear someone typing. Is that you, Steve?
My bad. Trying to respond to somebody.
No problem. I thought maybe you were going to send me an important message, so I just wanted to check in. The next service that we have here is Microsoft Stream, which is, think of it like YouTube is a popular competitor, but it's really designed for, at this time, for internal sharing of video. So if you wanted to create a video that's has a YouTube-like interface or the ability to embed internally, not externally, Stream would be a good tool for that. And after that is Sway. And the most popular competitor to Sway I could think of is like Prezi, which became popular a few years back. So a Microsoft version of like a presentation software with a, it kind of zooms in and out to different pieces of text or images. And it just really creates similar to PowerPoint, but just more, it's like a prettier version of a PowerPoint presentation. And you can take those and embed them on a web page, for example, so people can have a really interactive reporter presentation. And following that on our list here is Microsoft Teams, which is really has really become one of the most popular and powerful apps in the Office 365 suite. And it is very, it has a lot of interactions with SharePoint, but what Teams is great at is that it creates conversational, a conversational interface to managing information and collaborating. So one of the tools I like to point out first with Teams, and we'll be getting into this later with our Teams presentation, but is chat. So if you ever had used Skype or MSN Messenger or ICQ, or a lot of those chat apps from your computer, Microsoft Teams, one of the great first uses is that. And then on top of that, it has the ability to create Teams. So you can create a chat interface or a file storage space right within a team within this application. So like I said, we'll be getting into that more soon. So if you haven't used it yet, or you're just wanting to learn more about it, please plan to attend our Microsoft March session on Teams. The next one I pointed to earlier, and that's Microsoft To Do. That's just a list of your tasks, and it gives you a lot of cool tools in terms of setting a due date or a follow-up date or having it do a reminder so it pops up when it's time to do it. I know some people like to use their calendar for this, but I'd really encourage you to keep your calendar for scheduling your time of where you're going to be and when, and keep use To Do for your tasks of what you're going to be doing during those times. And the last one I think we're going to be talking about now is Microsoft Whiteboard, which is a cool tool for ideation and collaboration on a freeform canvas. So it's exactly what it sounds like. It's a whiteboard. And once we're back on campus again, you'll find some of our rooms have whiteboard built into them, and you're able to share between that screen and someone at home working on a canvas. And what they write on their side of the whiteboard appears for you, and then you can simultaneously be collaborating on whatever you're writing on the whiteboard. So it's a really cool tool. And I do actually have one more down here, Flipgrid, which is new to the Microsoft family. I believe Microsoft acquired them a few years back and has been working to integrate them into the Office 365 suite. And the best way I could describe Flipgrid is it's a way to create videos and share them in groups similar to TikTok. Like, it's fun. You can add a lot of filters or you can do a lot of cool editing functions, and there's apps for it. So one demonstration we had in our technology roundtable for Flipgrid was you create a group, you ask a question. So what did you do for spring break, for example? And this would really be great, I think, in a classroom where if you wanted everyone to be contributing something, you could create a group around a topic and say, okay, I just want everyone to spend a couple minutes talking about this topic so that I can really get a sense of what you understand. And they can do it in a way that's fun rather than just a person sitting in front of a screen talking. They can add a lot of cool filters and images, and it's just a fun way to share those videos and topics. So there it is. I think we've touched on all of the apps within Office 365. Steve, anything that I've left out or anything else that you want to touch on?
No, one thing that I was reflecting on as you were kind of going through the different apps, you know, we were talking about how Forms can feed into Power Automate, and, you know, Teams can feed into Power Automate and Forms. There's a lot of interconnectivity between the applications that are offered here. Some of it is quite surprising how easy it is. Some of it can be a little bit more in depth, but there's a powerful base here to help collaboration and just kind of bringing about working together, sharing files and getting things done around the university that can be had here. And it's the place to start when you're looking for something. If you need to gather information, you know, from a survey, right? First place to look would be Microsoft Forms. The next place I would look for that would be our Qualtrics application, where we have that. There's a lot of tools here that can help get things done. And it's a great place to start. And since MinState has worked with Microsoft, you know, all these tools are vetted through our I want to say our lawyer team, but that's probably not the right verbiage. But they're vetted through the state, and they have approval and have met with the different regulations surrounding FERPA and student data. So it is really great, the best place to start.
Yeah, that's a really great point. So if you have a team that's looking for a solution, to first look at Office 365 and see if that can solve what you're looking for. Because I mentioned a lot of competitors as we were going through these apps. And what's great about Microsoft and Office 365 is, like you said, they've been vetted. We know that they are implementing these solutions in a way that protect our students' data, our data, and that it, as long as you implement it securely and that you're being mindful about who you give access and to what, these solutions have been vetted and approved for use. So if you can solve, and another great point is that they're already bought and paid for. So if you're a department looking for a project management solution and you can use Planner, it's there ready to be used. And it's not only are they there and bought and paid for, but they're frequently, in many of these cases, I think, leading the industry in each of these solutions. So OneNote, for example, is, as far as I know, the best note-taking app that you can get. Some people maybe like Evernote or Google Keep or something like that, but OneNote, feature for feature, you know, can match those other solutions that maybe you've used in other organizations or as a student in high school. So to look at what Office 365's version of a piece of software that maybe you were previously familiar with, and you'll see that it has a lot of the same features. And like I said, it prioritized ensuring that that data was kept in a secure way that met the requirements of the university and the state, whether it's complying with FERPA or the Minnesota Data Government Practices Act. These solutions have all been vetted and approved for use. So learning more, I think that's where I'd like to go next, Steve, or Is there something else I should cover, or should I move on to LinkedIn Learning?
No, let's touch on LinkedIn Learning.
Okay. All right. So from my browser here, I'm going to show you, if you wanted to get to know, if you can't wait for our presentations later this month, or maybe you want to learn about one of these apps that we're not going to be covering during the Microsoft March, a great place to do that is LinkedIn Learning. So I'm going to switch over to my account here, and I'm going to give you a little tip here for searching. Anytime you want to search something on the university, just type in MNSU and then whatever it is you're searching for. And I just searched MNSU LinkedIn Learning, and my top result there is the university's page on using LinkedIn Learning. And LinkedIn Learning is just a really great training platform for learning lots of things, but it was purchased by Microsoft and combined with the LinkedIn unit, which is also part of Microsoft. And so it really has emphasized, you can learn lots of things. There are lots of pieces of software, but there's a lot of great training around Office 365 specifically. So if you search that MNSU LinkedIn Learning, and we can provide these links as well, and then go here and choose login or create an account. And as it says here, you'll be asked to log in with those same credentials. So with our MnState login credentials, it's your star ID at go.minstate if you're a student, or your star ID at minstate.edu for faculty and staff. So I'm gonna choose login. And I've already set up my account, so it's gonna take me right into my LinkedIn Learning page. And you can see some of the courses that I have in progress in preparation for this demonstration today. I had to spend some time looking at the Office 365 new features just to see if there was anything there we wanted to cover, or Microsoft 365 essential training for administrators. So those are some of the training courses that I've gone through, but there's really a lot of stuff here. So I mentioned Outlook as like the starting place for almost everyone. And the basics of getting up and running on Outlook are easy, but if you really want to dive in on some of the features, like maybe how to route messages to a specific folder or set up auto reply or any of that kind of stuff, just come here, search for Outlook, and you'll see there's a session here, Outlook Essential Training for Office 365. And even better, once you get into the course, it's going to autoplay there. That's okay. You can see there's a really well done index here on the left. And so if you're looking for a specific piece of information, like maybe how to create search folders, you can find it right over here and click it. Additionally, there's a transcript of everything that's being said in the training. So if you want to search within the transcript, like I want to find the word, I want to know about searching. Maybe I can find a better example here. So I'm looking at the transcript for this section specifically. But if I want to search, for example, every time, what's a good example? Calendars. It can take me right to that part of the video. So I don't know if you saw that. Once I clicked accept, it found where calendars is mentioned within this section and took me right there. So it's not only a great library of trainings, but the interface and the ability to search within a training for specifically what you're looking for is just really powerful and a really great tool. So even if you've been an Outlook user for many years, or a Word user, an Excel user, go here and watch one of these trainings. You can even increase the speed. So if they're talking about something you already know about and you want to set it to 1.5, you can speed it up and just kind of listen to the training and what they're talking about. And maybe there's new features, or they've moved things around, or there's a tool there that will improve your productivity that you hadn't even considered before. So go to LinkedIn Learning, check it out, see even a piece of software, like I said, that you've been using for years, just watch the video or explore the index to see, or the contents to see what things maybe you don't know about. So that's my spiel on LinkedIn Learning. Steve, anything to add there?
I really think you did a great job and covered most of it.
All right. I guess one other part that I just remembered about LinkedIn Learning too, that you can create, and I'm going to forget what they're called right now. Learning Pathways, Steve? Am I remembering that correct? And it's basically a collection of videos. So if you're wanting students in your class, you're going to be expecting them to a collection, maybe a learning path or collection. So here, how to succeed as an online student is a learning path. So I'm going to click on that. And you can see that it's created by IT Solutions' very own Dr. Elizabeth Harsma. So she created this course called How to Succeed as an Online Student. And if you have a collection from LinkedIn Learning of things, if you're going to have students work on, maybe you're going to have them give a presentation, so you want them to be knowledgeable in PowerPoint, and you're also going to have them create databases in your class. You could have them work on Microsoft Access, and they could come here and you could assign a couple of videos right from this on things that they should get to know. All right, I think that's all I have on LinkedIn Learning. I'm just going to check my notes here to see if there's anything else. If there's anything you want to add, Steve, or if we have any questions coming in, feel free to let me know.
Yeah, I think in the meantime here, a question on how to get the desktop app versions of these, because we've went over how to access them on the web, but is there a way that they can download these to have the desktop client right there on their computer?
Thank you for whoever asked that question. This was real early in my notes and I think I went right over it. So thank you for whoever asked that question to remind me. Yes, what we're showing you right now is the web interface for using Office 365, but also you can download these apps and not just on your laptop or Mac, but also on your mobile devices. So I'm gonna start back from Outlook, the starting place that most people are at.
Yeah, each student, staff and faculty member are allowed up to 5 different copies of this, right? So if that's a combination of installed on a PC, a Mac, your phone, a tablet, there are 5 licenses of Office 365 that can be used per individual.
All right, so here I've opened up our demonstration account. I'm in Outlook, and from here to download then, if I wanted to put it on the computer I'm working on right now, I would click the app launcher or the waffle menu as we referred to it earlier. And then I would click Office 365. And you'll see this takes me to a page of recent information. So since this is a new account that we just created for this demonstration, I don't have any recent Office documents. If you're a regular user, you would see that kind of stuff here. Same thing with OneDrive, recent folders or SharePoint frequent sites. So. But up here in the upper right-hand corner, you'll see the Install Office button. And if I click that, it will give me a couple of options here. I can install the Office 365 apps, which includes Outlook, OneDrive for Business, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and more, which I believe the more is Microsoft Access and Publisher. Otherwise, there's other install options. So I'm just going to show what it looks like if I choose this first option. If I select that, you'll see 2 things happen. One, the download started. So you see here in my bottom left-hand corner, it downloaded an .exe file for installing this. And it gave me some instructions here for how to both install the app and then activate it using my MinState credentials. So I won't go beyond that other than to show that that's where you can get the installs for your laptops and Macs. For phones, it is a little different. And let me open my PowerPoint presentation here to show. I grabbed some screenshots of what it would look like in the App Store. So let me click from current slide. So here on my screen right now, I'm just showing some screenshots from the App Store on my iPhone. I searched the word Microsoft in the App Store. And here's some of the apps that I think, you know, if you're just getting started with the university or using Office 365, this is a great starting point. So Microsoft Authenticator, I mentioned that real early in the training for our multi-factor authentication security improvements that we're making so that when you try to sign into your Microsoft account to see your emails or to access that information that only you should have access to, it just provides a second prompt to make sure that it is in fact you logging in. Another great one to install is Microsoft Outlook. It's just a really good email app that includes both the mail and a calendar. It's what I really like about it is that it doesn't use my phone's mail client, which is where my personal emails are, so that I can have access to my work emails from my phone, but they're not part of my regular mail app. So when I'm after hours or on weekends or on vacation, I'm not seeing my work emails combined with my regular emails. I have those all compartmentalized off here into Microsoft Outlook. And then also Microsoft OneDrive. And I have a few more noted here. Microsoft OneNote. So once you create a notebook and you really commit to putting your information in there, having access to it anywhere you go just by pulling up your phone and searching, it's a really powerful tool. The Microsoft Office app, which just combines Word, Excel, and PowerPoint, and Microsoft Teams. So those are just a few I wanted to highlight. Steve, anything else that's worth mentioning at this point?
I think you've covered a lot of ground.
All right. I'm checking my notes. If there's another question, feel free to jump in. Otherwise, I'm going to check my notes to see if there's anything else I wanted to make sure we covered. Oh, here's a note I had about using different browsers. So maybe during this training, you've noticed I've kind of gone back and forth between a couple different windows of Chrome. One of them, my account, one of them using this demo account. One thing about accessing Office 365 on the web. One, we've been showing you how to do it in a web browser, which means it's inside of Chrome or Firefox or Microsoft Edge as a window into Office 365. You can install the apps and use it that way too, that's fine. But just specifically talking about accessing Office 365 in a browser, is what's important to note is that once you log in, and if you choose yes for it to remember you, that you're now going to be logged into that account with that browser indefinitely. So let's say somewhat indefinitely, for a long period at least. Let's say you also have a Microsoft Office 365 account from another institution or organization, and you click a link to try to get to that OneDrive, and it keeps taking you to this one. That's because your browser remembers who you are. And if you wanted to log out so that you could access that other account, you would come up here and choose sign out. Okay. And I think we just see some people occasionally run into issues where I've seen it with transfer students a lot, where someone's trying to access the Microsoft form that we created for new students to provide some information to the department, and they can't access it. And it's because they're part of another institution that has Office 365, and it's trying to access that form from that account rather than this one. So they need to come to the page and do the sign out process, or use a different browser. Or I think, Steve, your suggestion of using like a guest mode or an incognito mode, that makes your browser not remember who you are so that you can access a different account.
So we have a question in the chat. They say, is it a lifetime access for Office 365? So I think the question is, how long do they get access to these apps?
Great question. For staff, access is cut off 2 days after you end employment. For faculty, it's 1 year after you end employment. And for students, it's also 1 year after you are no longer enrolled. And Steve, if you have other information, please jump in here. I'm doing this from memory, but I believe those are the numbers that for staff, it's 2 days after your employment end date. You'll lose your access. For faculty, it's 1 year. And for students, it's 1 year.
And then I believe there's a special case for alumni. I think alumni continue to have access to their email as long as it's active and being used. I'm not 100% sure on some of those rules, but I believe that's another exception.
I think you're exactly right. I seem to recall that alumni are converted to a different licensing type where they don't have access to the full Office 365 suite of tools and information, but they continue to have their Outlook and email address so that they can continue to use those. And I'm just going to use my trick here of searching MNSU Office 365 licenses. And I suspect we have a knowledge article on it. And we do. So here's a full list. I just searched Microsoft Office 365 licenses, and you'll see some of the information I talked about here. So faculty, they have full Office 365, 365 days from the last day of employment. And then faculty email mailboxes will be disabled after the 365 day period. And staff, it's 2 days after. So different processes depending on what your affiliation with the university is. Any other questions?
Something that I think you guys could touch on a little bit, and something that we see commonly, is that Some students or employees might come into the university having used other service providers in the past that have similar apps. But can you just touch on why it is that we use Office 365 here at MSU, and what are the benefits, or why does it work so well for us? And also why we are encouraging everyone who are an employee or a student to really dive into these apps and utilize them.
So I've been a big fan of technology and interested in enterprise tech for many years. And there's just, when you look for a solution provider, like Microsoft or some of the competitors, or Google or Salesforce, or maybe they're not a good example, but if you just look at the total package that Microsoft has, they just have so many solutions in so many areas. So I'm guessing that's the best explanation I can give, is that they had what we need when we needed it, and they've continued to progress their solutions along so that they're not all the solutions have been competitive as some of the best in class. So that's my personal opinion. Steve, I don't know if you have any differing thoughts or opinions based on your experience, but.
Yeah, I think it goes back to that the Office 365 has been vetted through the state and Minnesota State University Mankato as the platform of choice. Going through the rules and verifying that, yes, it meets our requirements. It's the place to start. The next one I would touch on is that the interconnectivity between not only everybody at MSU, but the Minnesota State organization as a whole. If you're working with a sister school in Winona or St. Cloud, you can easily share information there as well, and to the outside world as a whole. It's not locked down to MSU. So that ability that it's been vetted, that it's ease of sharing, and there are some great tools here. And if you're coming from another platform, it never hurts to explore something new and being comfortable with adjusting. Because if we've learned nothing over the last year, is that the only constant in life is change. And so being able to adapt to new technologies, new platforms, and being able to embrace that tech and kind of push it to the limits is going to serve you well, no matter where the road of life ends up taking you.
Yeah, I completely agree that this happens to be what we use here, but you might students who are graduating and moving on to another organization might use a competitor, but they'll know what's possible with these solutions, and they'll likely have a similar solution wherever they go. But Office 365 just has so many solutions, and it's worked for us for so many years that I think that's probably an explanation of how we got to where we're at.
All right, thank you. And then I think one more question that I think would be good to touch on is to talk a little bit more about the sharing and collaborative nature of a lot of these apps, especially things like Word and PowerPoint, where teams can work together with each other on the same document, even at the same time.
Sure. Maybe I'll jump in and do a quick demo of that. So I'm going to hop over to Microsoft Word and create a new blank document. And I'm going to get started right away. I know I'm hit with a privacy option. Like I said, this is a new account, so we're going to get a lot of those warnings the first time we use these solutions. But so I just typed hello world, but I think I really reached the end of what I can contribute to this document, and I really need Steve's help. So up here in the upper right-hand corner, you'll see a share button, and or what I like to call the share square. So in almost all apps these days, you'll see a little square with an arrow on it, and I like to call it the share square. It's just an indication that this is where you can go to quickly share a document. So I'm going to choose share here. And because this is part of our tenant and it already has all of our information in here, I know that I can easily add Steve just by typing his last name, comma, first name. And there it searched for him. And I'm looking for the Steve Rodman, who is a business analyst and designer. So some people with maybe more common names, like I know there's another Brian Johnson on campus, for example, you don't want to give him the access. You want to make sure that you're giving it to the right person. So here I've searched for Steve. I know he's an analyst. I know that's his icon, so I'm going to choose him. And then I can click send and he'll have edit access. Or let's say I only want to give him view access because I don't want him messing with my brilliant words of hello world. I could toggle in here and turn off editing. Or if I just wanted to share the link with people that already have access, I could choose that. So there's lots of options here, but the most common is what I was showing initially is just the searching for the person and giving them edit access. And then I would click send. And Steve will be getting an email in his inbox saying, Brian shared this document with you called, currently it's named Document and Hello World. But in this app, I can change all the different ways. I can change the name. I can change where it's stored. And I could share it or add comments or all the stuff that you could do in Word. Additionally, so let's say I'm done with in Word here. You can do the same thing from OneDrive. So the great thing about OneDrive, I know some people are still using the EnDrive, which is a great service provided by IT Solutions. But one of the benefits of OneDrive is that it takes storing your documents to anywhere in the world and available through many different apps without having to connect using a VPN or kind of wonky interfaces of trying to use the web. Microsoft has an interface that's mobile responsive and really works with almost any browser and any operating system in the world. So here I just popped over to OneDrive and this would be another place where I could share this document. So I could click the share square again. And now I want to add Alexis. So I'm going to search by her last name. And there I see it's Alexis Otter from Information Technology. And I can click that and choose send. And now Lexi will have access to that.
Awesome. Yeah, there's some really great functionality in there that's really helpful. It makes things go really quick and it makes working in a team so much easier, especially when we see more people working remotely these days. So those are really cool functionalities. All right. Thank you, Brian and Steve, for you guys' awesome presentation. We're getting close on time here. We just have a couple of minutes left. I'm going to leave maybe a few minutes at the very end for some final questions. If you have any, please feel free to share them now. But first, I have just a couple of reminders before you guys jump off to share. There we go. So if you're interested in viewing other IT Solutions webinars on other topics, you can go to mankato.mnsu.edu/ITS webinars. And here you can find sessions on lots of different topics like cybersecurity, tech tools for remote working, tips for university website editors, and lots more. So those are all there for you as well. And lastly, to stay up to date with the latest campus technology news, get tech help and support, or explore other resources, you can go online to our IT Solutions website at mnsu.edu/ITS. And don't forget to find us on Facebook at ITSMSU and follow us on Twitter at ITSMNSU. We're pretty active over there, so you'll find lots of good tech tips. All right. With that, if you all have any final questions, go ahead and send them in the chat and I'll read them off. I do have one final thing to touch on that I think is a good question. Where can our audience or others go to get help and support for specific Office 365 topics? I know we touched on LinkedIn Learning, but are there support articles that they can view or search if they have questions later on?
Absolutely. So like I said, if you search any topic just by searching, MNSU Office 365 licenses like I did before, that will search our website for support articles. But if you want to limit your search to just support articles, we have an entire page just to that. So explore support articles on the IT Solutions website. And here I could type in Office 365. But as always, if you're not able to find the answer on your own, contact IT Solutions. My favorite way is IT Solutions Center at mnsu.edu, but I know there's lots of other ways as well.
Yeah, and I did share some of those links in the chat too. So if you need to find our submit a ticket page or you want to find our support articles page or more information on Microsoft March, those are in the chat for you there as well. All right, I don't see any other questions. So unless Brian or Steve, you all have any other last things to mention?
That's all I've got. Thank you, Lexi. Appreciate it.
Okay, sounds good. Well, that concludes our first Microsoft March webinar. Thanks so much for joining us. Don't forget to register for upcoming ones and check out our resources online. Have a wonderful day.